This is pretty cool. There are still modern applications being written for PowerPC OS X. So in this video, we're going to talk about those. They might be few and far between, but I'm going to look at a few using my PowerMac G4. Some of them are pretty impressive, so let's start with my favorite, Discord Lite. Written by the one and only DOSDude1. This simple Discord client carries most of the ability to use text chat, and it's up for free on GitHub. Sign in, click a group, and it takes a few seconds for it to load, but you'll be able to use chat using Discord. It's designed for 10.4 Tiger and works on 32 and 64-bit Intel Macs and later versions of OS X as well. For me personally, the charm is being able to use this on my PowerMac G4, but it also works on 10.6 Snow Leopard. Here it is running on a MacBook 2007 using 10.6. Next up is Legacy AI, because it wouldn't be almost 2025 without sticking AI on everything. This one is especially impressive as it works all the way back to System 7 up to 10.11 El Capitan, and it also has the bragging rights of being developed before the official iOS application and Mac application. Manticore, the developer, deserves some love for this one. It's a no-frills application, but it is nice that you can easily work with ChatGPT. It's a great way to get misinformation even in retro computing. By default, it uses ChatGPT 3.5, but if you are a registered user, you can use later version models. It's only $15, and the funding supports the project. At this point, I think everyone knows how chatbots work, so I'm just going to move on. I need to reiterate that I'm using ChatGPT and Discord Lite on a 20-year-old computer. That's impressive, right? At least to me it is. The following three applications all cover the same space. The first two applications are so similar in name, it's to the point of confusion. The PPC Store and the PPC App Store. The third and final one being the Sorbet App Store. And as you probably guessed by the names alone, these are all trying to recreate an App Store on a PowerPC Mac. The PowerPC Store is made by the same guy who made Leopard Rebirth, which is a reskinning of Leopard to look like High Sierra. I find this interesting as generally the aesthetic of Aqua is more loved by the people who have an interest in retro computing rather than later versions of OS X. Personally, I'm a fan of both, so I'm not going to declare one superior. However, I'd argue that in later versions of Mac OS after Mac OS Mojave, this UI has somewhat regressed. Okay, I'm getting off topic. The PowerPC Store is really thin. There's not very many listings in this application. The few applications that are directly download on your desktop, which is strange. Maybe others will have better luck with it, but I can say we can just skip this one. The Sorbet App Store is a little bit better, but it's mostly just a front end to Macintosh Garden. Again, the selection's a bit thin, but at least it works. I'm not trying to be a jerk, but... that icon kinda hurts. Next up is the PowerPC App Store, and I'm sorry I'm going to butcher the developer's name, by Adrian Apria. It is a little more organized and offers a slightly cleaner experience. Like the PowerPC Store, it could use more listings, but it has been around since 2015, and the last update was in 2023. Again, I'd like to see more listings in this app, as it could effectively function as a roadmap for people new to retro OS X software. Just check out how thin the game section is. It's just woefully underpopulated. But it is a handy utility. I used it to download and install several applications such as Geekbench, iStat, and some others. Next up is web browsers, and this takes a bit of history to understand. As I'm sure you're aware, the web is ever-evolving, new standards are released, and thus web browsers must rush to adopt the new said standards. PowerPC Macs are forever stuck in OS 10.4 and 10.5, which is long past supported. The longest standing browser to bring modernish web support to OS 10.4 and 10.5 was Firefox with its extended support release, aka ESR. 10.4 Fox was the fork of the last release of Firefox for PowerPC Macs. This means that retro OS X browsers are a bit of a time capsule, as they are built by people trying to graft new features onto them. This is still much better than trying to use Safari 2.0, the browser that shipped with 10.4. To give a quick rundown on what 10.4 Fox was able to accomplish was Apple Script support, basic ad block, a reader view, media support for MP3, MP4, WebP, and later JavaScript support and AltaVec optimizations. On the topic of icons again, what the hell is up with the 10.4 Fox icon? It's really haunting. after 10.4 Fox was mostly retired, it was forked into Interweb PPC, which is a slightly optimized version of 10.4 Fox. Google.com works, so I'm going to use it to Google NPR.com, which I could have gone to directly, but I wanted to illustrate that Google.com is working. From the homepage, I'll click on a story, and let's not focus on the depressing nature of this content. Scrolling through the article does take a bit of time, and it's pretty choppy while it loads. Eventually, it does all load, and the graphics seem to be in order. Now, if I try to go to Ars Technica, punching that into the URL, and it starts to load, then crashes. I've relaunched the browser, now if I try to navigate to apple.com, it'll start to load, and then crash. Ironically, if you go to microsoft.com, the webpage loads and it looks very unbroken. I assume this is because Microsoft still has to support Internet Explorer, despite being sunsetted many years ago. Interweb is now decommissioned, but the story of OS X web browsers doesn't stop with Interweb PowerPC. We have a new browser as of August 2024. Its name is AquaFox, which is an attempt to merge in some of the later changes to 10.4 Fox with Interweb PowerPC. AquaFox is a bit funky as you download the version of the browser based on your CPU type. Since I'm on a PowerMac G4, I'm grabbing the G4 version. While it isn't exactly a modern web browser, it loads Ars Technica. Well, I mean with missing images, but you can click on articles and actually read them. Apple.com also loads, but with missing images. I'll take it, that's a pretty big improvement over crashing. Simple websites like Mac Rumors loads pretty nicely. Originally, I was going to do browser benchmarks, but there's just really no point. This is the web browser to use for PowerPC Macs. I doubt this browser will improve very much, but at least you can interact with the modern web. This is pretty cool, and I'm not being ironic. I'm very impressed by this. Also linked in the description is a list of old websites that have been compiled for older computers by Mac Rumors users. This next one isn't really retro Mac software so much as working with your retro Mac. One of the biggest problems is the I/O on these old machines is slow. The G4 only has USB 1.1, and burning disks is annoying to say the least. You can add USB 2.0 with a PCI card, but it's still slow, and FireWire 800 devices are faster but near non-existent. The fastest input-output on this G4 is networking, as it has a 1 gigabit Ethernet, which is about 125 megabytes a second, which is faster than FireWire 800. You could use your wired Ethernet to download stuff off the internet using a web browser, but the download speeds will be remarkably slower, at least in my experience. So easy enough, you just use another computer to download and network to it from your PowerMac G4. Well, not so fast. OS 10.4 Tiger and 10.5 Leopard do not support Samba, aka SMB2, making networking more challenging. Samba is a cross-platform file sharing system for file servers. On my Synology network attached storage, it does support SMB1, but the problem is if you try to enable it, you'll see a nasty message that SMB1 is not secure, and my NAS is connected to the interweb, so I don't want to do this. You'll want to set up your shares as Apple File Sharing Protocol, aka AFP, and this also applies to modern Macs. So now if I enable this, I can easily access my network attached storage just by grabbing the IP and using the AFP protocol by going to Network Connect, then punching in AFP followed by my address. If you have another Mac, you may be able to connect to it, although I have found some issues. Usually I have to connect from my newer Mac to my older Mac, and not the other way around. If you have a network attached storage or are considering investing in one, it's probably the easiest way for dealing with things like this. I know that was a bit of a tangent, but I felt it was important because this is the technique I use to get most of these retro applications onto my Mac and not using the retro web browsers. Because of the litigious nature of a certain Japanese video game corporation, I'm going to be a little coy in this section and brief because I don't want to have to pull this video. There's a certain plumber-based video game that has a pretty good port for PowerPC-based Macs. It is available on Macintosh Garden if you want to compile your own, but if you're sneaky on archive.org, you can find it. It's a pretty small download, and all you have to do is run the application from the terminal. Here you can see me playing it from Leopard. It runs surprisingly well, although I'd probably recommend not using your keyboard like I am right now. Anyhow, I think I'm risking enough, so we'll just move on. This is not the only game that has an unofficial PowerPC OS X port. I made two videos, one about the story of Half-Life for the PowerPC Mac and why that didn't work out, and the port you can actually play today, as well as one on a unofficial port of Grand Theft Auto 3 that is totally weird. It mostly works, but doesn't. So check those videos out, they'll be linked in the description. Seriously, I recommend checking these videos out if you haven't seen them, because look at Grand Theft Auto here. What is this? And Half-Life? It's not that much better, is it? Now for our final entry, TigerBrew. If you're a power user on macOS, you've encountered Homebrew. It is a package manager for macOS, mostly used for installing and managing CLI utilities, akin to using something like apt on Linux. If you're not a terminal user, think of Homebrew as a command line to App Store. There are gazillions of applications that you can install using Homebrew, as well as version managers for languages like Ruby and Python and utilities like Node. In case you haven't put it together, TigerBrew is Homebrew for Tiger and Leopard. Installing TigerBrew is a multi-step process. The first thing you need is to nab the appropriate version of Xcode, either 2.5 for Tiger or 3.14 for Leopard. You can see I've run the Ruby V command and that Ruby is installed. You'll need to navigate in your terminal to where you placed your install script. Mine is in my public folder, so I'm going to type cd space public. Now I'm in the directory where my install script is and it's named install, so I'm going to write Ruby install and hit return. If you try and run brew at this point, it won't work. We need to add the path to homebrew in our bash profile. This can be easily done by running the export path command that's in the documentation. I already have this in a text file, so I'm going to copy and paste it into my terminal. While this isn't part of the documentation, it's advisable to run brew doctor to check for any potential problems. And it will also install a bunch of dependencies, which you will need for other applications. You will need to be patient because this will take a while. Alright, let's start with a really simple utility first, as the large ones can take a really long time with TigerBrew to install. Let's grab Archie, which is similar to ScreenFetch on Linux. Installing applications is easy, just run brew install Archie, and then hit return and wait. Once installed, we can run the command Archie. Alright, that's pretty cool, right? But let's take this a little bit further and take this screenshot and post it on Discord using Discord Lite. This right here is super cool to me, as I never thought this was going to be possible when I bought this G4. Let's do one more demo with TigerBrew. I've already run the command for brew install image magic, a very popular CLI utility for converting and batch processing images. I already know how to use this utility and I don't really want to spend time making a tutorial within this video on how to use image magic, as there's already so much documentation for it out there. So I'm just going to run a simple demonstration by using convert to change image formats. I'll start by typing the command and dragging the screenshot I have in my desktop to the terminal to get its path, then converting it to a JPEG. Since I'm lazy, to get the same path again, I'm going to drag the file back onto the terminal window and change the suffix. Hit return, and it works. Hopefully you get the idea. There are many CLI utilities that you can install with TigerBrew. Brew search will let you search what packages are available, and there are a lot. Alright, that concludes my list of new applications for PowerPC Macs. Please let me know if there's any ones I missed. If there's enough cool applications, I'll do a follow-up video.
Thanks for watching to the end, and again, this is a point where I just say thank you to my Patreons for keeping this mid-roll ad-free. You guys are amazing.